everybody. All right. Well, hopefully this is a round table so we can try to be as informal as possible. Rose is graciously saying I should go first. I'm going to do, try to go through as detailed as I can through the chapter 11 of the Lotus Sutra. And I'm going to do that right now, which is beholding the stupa. And you're going to see. And I wanted to just give us a little background. We're all pretty much familiar with what the Lotus Sutra is, but I just wanted to say where we are in the development of the sutra so far. We just had finished chapter 10. Chapter 10 ended with the Buddha's explanation of the mind frame necessary for teaching the Lotus Sutra in the latter days, Mambo, and the merit that follows as a result of us steadfastly teaching. So it's a very important chapter 10. But chapter 11 radically changes. Chapter 11 through 22, just so we understand where we are, is talking about the higher dimensions. I'll talk about that later, but chapter 11 through 22 is a shifting of the assembly of the bodhisattvas and their preaching to a different location. Okay. So what happens is, in chapter 11, is immediately and suddenly a wonderful and majestically and beautifully decorated tower or stupa emerges from the earth and stands high in the sky. A voice reverberates from the stupa, resounding throughout the sky, extolling what Shakyamuni has heretofore been preaching. Note here, the listeners are struck with wonder and awe, and they don't understand what's happening. They don't understand what's happening, despite the fact that they're well-known bodhisattvas. This is a significant shift in the sense that the earth here, according to our wonderful founder and many other Buddhists as well, the earth signifies our own life. And the stupa comes from our own lives. One of the terms that came to my mind when I looked at the sutra, when I read it, is codependent origination. The idea that everything comes together at the same time. Our lives are connected to everything. And so Buddha nature comes from this interconnectedness of all life. The stupa that comes up has in it, I'll read it directly from here. It has it here, it says, you hear the abundant treasures, Tathagata. And it says, the Tathagata, well, what is the Tathagata? The Tathagata means one who comes from truth.
Is that a human being?
Well, the Buddha was at one time, and he's a deceased Buddha. The Buddha supposedly, in the chapter, explains it, from the east. Shakyamuni explains that later on in the chapter. He comes from the east. And but in this case, just for the general discussion, the Tathagata means one who comes from truth, or the world of truth. Hence, the Tathagata, being in the stupa, means that perfect truth resides in the earth and in us. That's what it's saying. You know, truth comes from there. Founder says, truth in this sense is the final and real aspect of the universe. So the Tathagata, having the stupa, emerging from the earth, is the final and true aspect of all of the universe. One of the things he points out here, I mean, people can jump in, we can have a discussion, that's what we're here. One of the things he said here, the founder had pointed out, said, in other words, the void or kuwa emptiness. He associates truth here with ku or emptiness, which is a concept. One of the things, however, sometimes we hear that term, what's empty? Empty, right? Emptiness. It sort of seems like it's, you know, it's disconnected. But the answer to that is empty of what? What does it mean, empty? Empty of a separate self. It means that we're all interconnected. That's the truth. The truth is that we're all interconnected, despite having seemingly our human limited dimensions. All right. All right, and that's why the stupa then represents the Buddha nature. Now, the key thing is that the term east, one of the things if you read the sutra, in the sutra when discussing the Tathagata, means that truth was there from the beginning of time. If you realize that the Tathagata is the Tathagata from the east, he is from the beginning of time. Now, why has the Tathagata come to this assembly? You know, all of a sudden this emergence, again, we had this situation where these people were there. He had just finished this congregation and had this discussion about these people being fantastic teachers. Why now does the Tathagata come? The Tathagata comes to the assembly, and what is his purpose? And it's made clear when Shakyamuni says, the Tathagata, abundant treasures, made a great vow. A great vow. And Founder discusses at some length what vows are in his writings. He talks about this, and actually, so you know it, if we had the book, you could look at it. It's,
I have this one. It's called
Buddhism for Today. Buddhism for Today, the book. On page 133, he talks about the great vow and the general vow. And the general vow is the one that we all take. You know, basically the idea that we're here to help other people, other beings from their suffering, wherever they may be. Not just humans. You okay?
Excuse me.
All beings. And so the Tathagata, however, comes here and he actually is talking about a special vow. Founder, let me just read that on page 134 for a second. Founder talks about special vows.
Is that a law? The vow
is not a law, but the general vow is the one that all Buddhists take, right? Mm-hmm. But a special vow usually can refer to a person's vocation, right? Anybody can have a vocation. You can create a special vow. In fact, you're encouraged to make special vows that will encourage you to
commit.
Do well in your...
Exactly,
to commit to. But all Buddhas have special vows.
Yes.
For example, Founder points out on page 134, besides general vows to save all living beings, each Buddha has his own special vow, such as the 48 vows of the Tathagata Amida Buddha, and the 500 great vows of the Tathagata Shakyamuni. But in this case, Tathagata Abundant Treasures has one vow. And that vow is, he says, after I became a Buddha and then extinct, if there's a place in any land in the universe where the Dharma Flower Sutra, I'm reading directly from the sutra, is taught, in order that I may listen to it, my stupa will appear there, bearing testimony to the sutra and praising it, saying, well done.
So is the stupa a person?
No. The stupa is not a person.
What is that with me?
What are you saying? Is a stupa? Let's take a step back. What, Rose, do you want to... jump in, or you want to continue to tell me?
No,
it's okay.
I was just kind of boring.
Okay. No, a stupa is traditionally we put ancient people's relics frequently in, so people could frequently, you know, show veneration and respect to the ashes that remain.
Oh, okay. You've seen them.
Yeah. Yeah. There it is. That's what I'm saying. Right. So what happened here is that Tathagata Abundant Treasures says, he was a Buddha in the East. He says, when I die, what happens is create a stupa, and my stupa will go wherever this will be. After I become a Buddha, then extinct, if there's a place in any land in the universe where the Dharma Flower Sutra is taught, in order that I may listen to it, my stupa will appear there, bearing testimony to the stupa and praising it, saying, well done. And that's what's happened, because Shakyamuni now has preached the truth of the Lotus Sutra. And, I said, one of the other things I had in my notes, not necessarily in the order that family had, but just how it strikes me when I read this chapter, it says, another crucial component is that Shakyamuni Buddha purifies the world. See, because what ends up happening is all the emanations from all the, in order for them to praise Tathagata, this stupa that's come, they call forth all the other emanations of Shakyamuni Buddha, which is also an insight that we hadn't heard before. It says, Shakyamuni Buddha purifies the world and all of the other Buddha lands throughout the universe. Significant because it shows that there are not two lands, impure or pure, but rather one land of purity, depending upon our appreciation or our mind. And the quote I was going to use was, proof was from writings of Nichiren Daishonin. And one of the things that you see here is he has on attaining Buddhahood in this land. He uses this statement. He says, there are not two lands, pure or impure in themselves. The difference lies solely in the good or evil of our minds. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what that's trying to get to. Saying that depending upon our mindset, we'll determine whether or not we are in a pure and impure land. It's not that heaven is some other place or hell is some other place. It's really in us. Right. So then the other thing I had was... So there's another act connected to the Shakyamuni and the great vow that is permeating all of his emanations, which are Buddhas from the universe, back to him to see, to bear witness. Again, I said this is very important. Why is this important? Founder pointed this out by saying that the emanations of the Buddha coming from all the different parts of the universe show truth is one, and that no matter where it is in other parts of the universe, it's coming from the one source. So I thought about... I'm sorry. Go ahead, what are you saying?
No, I'm just thinking about it. No matter where it came from, it's coming from one source.
It's coming from one source.
No matter what religion, denomination, whatever.
Exactly.
It's only one.
It's only one source. And that's why founders so adamant about into faith and things of that nature. Right. And so the other portion that I also thought was what President Nwana had said at the last time we had our big congregation. Remember our meeting that we had, right, last summer? Right. Mm-hmm. Remember he talked about Newton's law. Remember he talked about Newton's law and about gravity. I don't know if people remember that. And if you think about it, that's what he's again saying here. From the one source, from the one truth, these other truths, these other laws like gravity emerge. And if you understand the nature of life itself, you'll understand the fundamental nature of all truth. So that's why it's very important that we see these emanations coming back from Shakyamuni. Let's see. There's a lot in the chapter. There's a lot in the chapter. One other thing I think that's important, just from reading the chapter, is that the chapter takes place, it changes the location of the assembly. Because remember, I just said that the stupa shot up from the air. Mm-hmm. The bodhisattva was on the ground. Mm-hmm. They couldn't see the change. And so what they asked Shakyamuni Buddha to do is that, please, use your spiritual power and uplift us so that we can see the abundant treasures of Buddha and Tahopa Buddha in the stupa. And that's what he does. So it's really their faith in the Buddha at this point that raises them up in a way to see the Tathaka. One of the things I wanted to say again, so we had the two places and the three assemblies. That's important too. First you had the historical assembly. The Buddha gets everybody at Eagle Peak, or you can call it Eagle Peak or Divine Vulture Peak. It then shifts into the air, and then you have the assembly. It's one assembly, the assembly in the air, and then when they come back again. So that's significant. Another way to look at this is also a shift between the historical dimension and the ultimate dimension. The historical dimension is what we live in every day. That's what, in this case, the Buddha is now shifting us to the ultimate dimension. That is beyond birth and death. Those are the main things that I saw here. Some of the other things that some other people had seen, not me, some other people had seen at our study group. They talked about the vow. I also wanted to point out that at the end where it says, "Wonderful Dharma, Flower Sutra, the great impartial wisdom, the Dharma by which bodhisattvas are taught and which Buddhas protect and keep in mind, this is on our sash." That language is actually on our sash. It's actually what's written there, and that's important. That's important. There are reasons why it's important. We don't have to go into that, but it's actually important. They stress that. And, well, I'm going to stop there. And with Rose, let's say our different things.
Okay.